This is Bill Putman. I'm a climate scientist at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. What you're looking at is a supercomputer model of carbon dioxide levels in the Earth's atmosphere. The visualization compresses 1 year of data into a few minutes. Carbon dioxide is the most important greenhouse gas affected by human activity. About half of the carbon dioxide emitted from fossil fuel combustion remains in the atmosphere, while the other half is absorbed by natural land and ocean reservoirs. In the northern hemisphere, we see the highest concentrations are focused around major emission sources over North America, Europe, and Asia. Notice how the gas doesn't stay in one place. The dispersion of carbon dioxide is controlled by the large-scale weather patterns within the global circulation. During spring and summer in the northern hemisphere, plants absorb a substantial amount of carbon dioxide through photosynthesis, thus removing some of the gas from the atmosphere. We see this change in the model as the red and purple colors start to fade. Meanwhile, in the southern hemisphere, we see the release of another pollutant, carbon monoxide. This is a gas that's both harmful to the environment and to humans. During the summer months, plumes of carbon monoxide stream from fires in Africa, South America, and Australia, contributing to high concentrations in the atmosphere. Notice how these emissions are also transported by winds to other parts of the world. As summer transitions to fall and plant photosynthesis decreases, carbon dioxide begins to accumulate in the atmosphere. Although this change is expected, we're seeing higher concentrations of carbon dioxide accumulate in the atmosphere each year. This is contributing to the long-term trend of rising global temperatures. The Orbiting Carbon Observatory 2, or OCO2, will be the first NASA satellite mission to provide a global view of carbon dioxide. OCO2 observations and atmospheric models like GEOS-5 will work closely together to better understand both human emissions and natural fluxes of carbon dioxide. This will help guide climate models toward more reliable predictions of future conditions across the globe.
Born into a society fueled by mental slavery, capitalist, consumerist, corrupt. A single drop of rain, like billions before it, alongside it, dreams of something better. Begins her inevitable crusade, a one-way journey, down, 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 to that fabled Eden they call Earth, a heavenly garden of platonic forms. Falling through the sky, a speedy goodbye to friends and family, determined to be the first in a generation to reach her destination, to become the temporary ruler of this new dominion. A suicide mission, but some adventures are worth dying for, right? So she speeds like a bullet, unfazed as her comrades are causing crosswinds which carry them adrift, calloused as she sees them die, too young. But ever more resilient, ever more tenacious, ever more acidically intent upon justifying their self-slaughter by claiming the promised land below.
So, I've got a riddle yet. A man wearing a backpack is lying alone, face down, dead in a field. Who killed him? Well, this is a very old riddle, and the way my daddy told it to me is it's the pilot's fault. See, just before our man jumped out of a plane, the pilot gave him a broken parachute. Our man put it on, jumps, falls, pulls his cord, expects it to open, it doesn't, he hits the ground, you get the picture. But what I don't get, what I've never really got, is who jumps out of a moving plane with a broken parachute? Like you rely on something that much, you look after it, innit? Right. Or watch that door, don't need you when it closes. It's a fucking nightmare. No, look, you're all right. We don't charge for bags here. But I've had people come, buy a Kit Kat, grab an handful of my plackies and go over to Tesco Express for their milk. It's the same way with cardboard boxes. We used to have loads, you know, from deliveries and that, just not knocking around for spare stock. But these days, you look away for 2 minutes and they've been had. The thing is, and I know they did this to reduce plastic bag use, and that's probably a really good thing to do. And probably it's worked to an extent. But the thing is, people are still buying in exactly the same way. Loads of food, letting it go mouldy in their fridge, yogurt pots going out with the yogurt. It's 3 a.m. on January the 2nd. I'm lying on my back. On my left, the two tubes. One of them pulls out custody pus from my left lung. The other one keeps oxygen in my air supply. On my right is a heavyset nurse I don't know. She's got broad forearms and thick skin on her hands. I've been lying in this bed so long I've forgotten what fresh air tastes like, but it still feels pretty alien. Margarine. Fucking margarine. Do you know how much margarine I sell? I can't believe it's not bought. I can't believe it's not legal. It's disgusting the rate I sell it. Obese nation just gobbling it. You know, no forethought, no rations, no understanding of where the food comes from. They just eat. It's gonna last forever. It's like my niece, yeah? She's 4. And she walks around all day with her laces untied, thinking she won't fall over, thinking she'll be lucky forever. It's a fucking nightmare! So she's got very thick skin on her hands, yeah, and she's holding my hand and she's stabbing it. It's dark. And it's late and you wouldn't be tired, and she's trying to change my peripheral venous catheter, but she hits the wrong vein and the vein pops and it's bleeding and it's spurting. It's going higher than my eyes are, and it's landing on me and it's landing on my bed, and she's still holding my hand. It's 3:02 a.m. I'm crying. I don't know it, but I am. I'm crying. And nurse it, rubs my hand, and tells me, oh, it's okay. So it's January the 16th. It was 6 days before I could stand up. After that, I hobbled a little further along the ward every night. It's kind of like my treat to myself. Like, in somewhere like that, you've got to have rhythms and routines, otherwise you go crazy. Like, I used to love Lucozade, orange, yeah? But if I drank it after 5 p.m, I would never get to sleep. So no Lucozade after 5. I had to change my consumption in line with my environment. After 12 days, I made it to the cardiovascular ward. That's the next ward over. I kind of a marker to myself. And this smoke. The rate these people smoke, we sell out of this every day. People heaving in toxins into themselves, getting it all caught up. Buying in disease, and the NHS is bowing under the weight of it. Fat bellies collapsing on top. And all the while, we see the government supporting big businesses. They're trying to keep supermarkets open later on Sundays, you know. See, everyone thinks this stuff is economics, but it's not, it's cultural. And our culture isn't changing. And if it is, it's not fast enough, and it certainly isn't deep enough. As I see it, so long as it's little shops like me, little businesses where once in a while we have to tell people we're out of milk, so long as it's little people like me who take the brunt of it, I just don't see how much difference 5p is going to make. So, it's the 16th. And tonight, I'm going outside. Not for long. I'm not going home, but that car park, that's like nothing. It's cold, and it's fresh, and it's delicious, and it's good, you know. You get a load and you hold it for as long as you can, and you put it back because you're not being greedy, and then you go back for some more, and it's fresh and it's clean and you can feel it healing you. And that's Manchester, innit? That's not on top of some mountain somewhere. That's Manchester. M15, one postcode over from where I grew up. Fresh. Fresh air. A year ago, I would have been making a cig out here. But today, I'm 17 years old, and I just think about how good it feels to be alive. It was years ago that, no. I still remember my 20s. Burning holes in my parachute like I was gonna last forever. I can't breathe sometimes. I'm falling that far towards the ground. I've smelt a man lying in his own shit for hours. I've woke up all night long in the company of cancerous coughing. I've showered with the door unlocked because things aren't always that easy. Some things are too human to forget. I think what I'm trying to say is we've all got to go sometime. But the views, like nothing.
I am 58 years old. I was raised in Colombia. I have 11 siblings. Well, that's from my mom and my dad. I still don't know how many kids my dad had. I know 11. 7 men and 4 women. I am the youngest of all of them. I have 3 children. I'm single. Well, still officially married. But I'd rather not to talk about that. We were raised in a little town, a green space full of trees, animals, and flowers. I mean, imagine 11 children playing around. Food was my favorite time. My dad used to bring loads of fish, and we used to help my mom to harvest the crops. That was funny. My brothers, they always had more power than me and my sisters. I thought it was a thing that was meant to be like that, but I didn't realize what that meant until I got older. Education. We did go to school, but education wasn't a priority, to be honest. I don't know why. Then my father decided to move to the city, to the big capital. Our small house that was my mom's property had coal under the ground. Obviously, with the time, he realized that meant money. So all my brothers got involved in the business, but me and my sisters had to stay at home. We were not allowed to work or study. That's why education is so important for me and my kids. I mean, I wanted them to have the lifestyle I always wanted. What did I want them to study? I mean, I don't care if it's business or engineering. That's better. You know what I mean? I mean, I don't want them to finish like me. How did I finish here? I mean, it's hard to express the reason why. This is the kind of situation where there are lots of things, lots of reasons, but you can choose which one is the biggest one. Yes, my husband, insecurities, my husband was kidnapped twice. He was one of the rich ones in Bogota, but he was originally a poor kid. Here is the perfect example of what a successful man is. One of the rich guys is being kidnapped by his childhood friend. My husband had a successful career and he overcame all his challenges in his life. And this man, he just didn't have the mindset. So he finished like lots of poor people in Colombia, getting radicalized. It's those people that created Colombian bad reputation. As my dad moved to another city, I decided to move to Spain to follow the European dream. That's how he called it there. I mean, after my husband being attacked twice, me trying to follow this dream, believing this is the way for happiness, because that's what we're aiming for, right? Due to all the things that were going on at that time at Colombia, lots of poor people were moving to Spain. Just a reminder, I'm not poor like them, I'm different. I'm moving because I want my children to have a better education, better opportunities. I'm different. Who am I to say poor people now? I'm a cleaner. No, but I feel rich inside. I live in a great place. I have a 3,000 pound watch, have three Ralph Lauren handbags. Maybe made in China, but still look expensive and it's good quality. I'm not a cleaner. I'm better than other cleaners. I have a background. Yes, I didn't care if I had to clean, if I had three jobs, if I didn't see my kids, if I had to call them every 2 hours to make sure they were doing their homework, because they needed to be the best students. They needed to go to the best universities. I mean, I didn't care if I had to pay more money to go to the private school. I'm not putting my kids in a state school. I'm not racist, but those gypsies and those people, they're not good for my kids. Yeah, so there, my husband worked, and I had to work as well, and at the same time as being a mom. Do you know what that means? Yes, I needed to take care of all of them, including him. I did wake up at 4, make sure they had breakfast, he had breakfast. I needed to leave my kids 2 hours before they started school because I was scared something were going to happen to them on the way to school. Started work at 8, finished first stop cleaning, second stop factory, third stop cleaning, picked up Maria from school. Who is Maria? The girl I'm taking care of, but that she's not my daughter. Bus, walk, pain, butt, hips, butt, balls, cleaning stuff, my kids, my kids, my kids! Came back at 10, at 9, and my three children are waiting for me at the balcony. What am I doing? I mean, you might think, oh, she's racist, she doesn't have any education, she's so fake, she's so superficial, she doesn't know what she's talking about, she's a cleaner! Why are you judging me? I spent 14 years working as a slave. Just for one thing. One small thing. A passport. A fucking piece of paper. And that's the best gift I have given to my children. I mean, 18 years later, why am I here? I think about how happy we were all together at the countryside with my family. But it's funny. Who am I to judge my dad? I follow his same steps. Because that's the way for happiness. Being ambitious.
Sleeve top. But the bump is still there. Like when you fell over as a kid and your mum would put a plaster on it and make it better again. But the scar is still there. And you begin to tell a story. When I was 7 years old, when my dad told me off to stop scratching. I got these scars across my legs because my teachers didn't understand me. If anger was a colour, I'd say it was bright red, but the kind of colour that is so bright it stains your eyes. And it soothes down with a dollop of cream. Massage. This one is from a chicken pox I never scratched. trans people said things I didn't like. So I took it out on my skin. Sometimes, when I itch, I'm not conscious of it. I'm like a driller, digging deeper and deeper, uncovering layer after layer of skin. And then I put cream on it to soothe the pain. But mentally, I've achieved success because I've finally picked that scab off. And then a scar appears. Like this one. Just a couple of weeks old. And all my skin is doing is working, moving and attaching itself with the rest of my body. But every time it suffers, it goes through a process. Heal, scratch, heal. I think every part of our body tells a story. Stories that are left unsaid, but carry that memory. Our eyes tell us so much. There is so much story in the eyes. Some we express, some we suppress. Just like the planet, we build up to knock down to make our lives better. But has anyone really stopped to think what Earth wants? What Mother Nature wants? Like we always say, God knows. It becomes a thought for a minute, an hour, a day. And life continues again. And that thought becomes insignificant. Because in the end, she gets angry by all this pressure to create, to think in the future instead of the present. Previous generations have fucked us up. We're screwed living in a fucked up world. Mother Earth is so beautiful, like a traffic light. 1 minute she is calm, the next she throws sunshine, hailstorm, rain and snow, like a girl on her first day in a period, conflicting through emotion to emotion in 0 to 10 seconds. Sometimes there's barriers. I follow the crowd and I become a sheep. I can be friends with anyone. I have to be their personality. I have 3 personalities. The workmate, where I'm like, hiya, you're right there. Did you find everything you was looking for? Do you want a bag for 5p? Oh, that's lovely, that item. I was eyeing it up myself. When really? I don't even like the clothes, and I can't even be asked with the day. And then there's the acting me, where I put on this posh accent. I mean, I don't speak like the Queen, but I tend to pronounce my words properly to fit in. And then I get a casting for a Manc accent, and I get worried because I'm thinking I need to be Manc, even though I am Manc. And then there's the real me, where I'm like, yeah, Mum, that's hanging that. And I'm accepted. I'm fearful no more. Other times, I'm a sloth and I just do my own thing. But there's a sense of urgency in today's society that we need to know so much in such a short space of time. I don't like to be exposed, but I love to be in my element. When my jam comes on and I'm like, yeah, mate, tune. When I write a smart ass status or comment, I get loads of likes. Time stands still, and I can hear chants from the audience cheering me on, the camera zooming past me to catch all the action. Where's my fucking clap? Where's my encore? Facebook's become a craving. A necessity. Get up, brush my teeth, have a shower, go on Facebook. It's like a craving where you can't stop eating. A necessity which is vital. Just like my scars. I have created a story the virtual me. My body has become something else in a world that is at tipping point.
So, climate change, what's on TV tonight, innocent people are dying, I want a burger. What are you doing here? Listening to me right now. What are you expecting me to say? Or are you open to new ideas? Well, I'm not going to give you facts and figures to make you shiver. I'm not going to explain how animal farts mess up the atmosphere more than all the transport round here. Or how the air we're breathing won't even be breathable as the future becomes more near. Or how people are starving and hungry while most of food and water goes towards people getting one juicy burger. 2,500 gallons of water for that Mackie D's and a plane ride from London to New York. No, fuck all that shit. I could go on forever about how we ain't so clever, about how we're fucking ourselves right up our asses with a barge pole of greed and need while begging on our knees saying, please give me more TV and money. Oh, please fuck with me. I'm your bitch, please. Excuse me while I sneeze. Achoo! I've got allergies, allergic to bullshit and being deceived. So there's shit going on. What's good? What's bad? What makes you glad? What makes you sad? What's real? What's as tragic as Ian Beale? When you think about it, the only thing that's real is how the body feels. And if I were to discuss my relationship with my body, I'm already slightly scared. Because, I mean, it's confusing. How can words reflect the experience? Suppose all words are just judgments. Good or bad, they're just a bunch of stuff that's arise from people thinking and comparing. So if I were to start by talking about my relationship with my body, I would first start noticing what's going on right now. Then I start to feel a bit turned on. Then I start to feel a bit strange saying my relationship with my body. Like there's something else, something judging the body. I'm the whole body feeling stuff, right? Yeah. So, I really can't answer that question, my relationship with my body. A more appropriate question would be, what's my relationship with everything else? See, the human habit to define oneself with thought is strange because they're just a bunch of sounds that have been created that can symbolize stuff that can also be written down. People call this the ego, but fuck that name, forget it. It's the habit to find wholeness, the search for wholeness through thought. But thought will never satisfy for long because you're whole. Always moving, always changing, always receiving. To describe oneself with thought is strange because it's just a bunch of stuff and it'll always point away from being yourself. See, right now, you're sitting here and you're a one thing. It won't make sense because you're a one thing. are one thing very, very alive. Not a thinker controlling the body, a unique, whole, human, harmonious human being that's come out of nature. See, right now you're looking at me, and what am I supposed to do? Be? Seriously? What the fuck does that mean? It's a word, it's a sound, it's a vibration in this situation. And vibrating, well, that's what thinking is, except it's in your head. Vibrating. You do know we're a bunch of atoms vibrating, right? Actually, we're probably smaller, more invisible stuff than atoms. And everything's just that. Everything's just on the cycle of just that. So, a human being's basically just a blob of atoms breathing air with the impulse to vibrate higher and connect with what supports that. In other words, I've just been vibing with everything my whole life. There's all kinds of stuff going on affecting us, and that's been proven by science. So, here's the question. Are you gonna be playing with the music or pretending you're some cool prick? Are you gonna be dressing up or not giving a fuck? Are you gonna be expressing or repressing? And PS, from personal experience, the latter is depressing, not interesting. But I'm not here to get you to change, to combat climate change. The Earth's gonna be fine, all right? It's been through much worse than humans. It'll shake us off like a parasite. It'll go cancer, no air, bad weather, I swear. In a few million years, it's not gonna be in tears. But if we ain't vibing, we'll be fighting. But I'm not here to get you to bust new moves. Do whatever the fuck you want to do. I'm sticking to me like glue. Except I'm not glue, I vibe. And vibing higher and better with everything else is the right livelihood. So, if you want to party with me, party with me. And if you don't, that's alright.
Presentations. If not, don't worry, I'm going to give you a brief introduction into the company and some of the work we do, so you can all hear me. Superb. So, Monsanto is one of the leading, largest companies, delivering agricultural products to farmers all year round. Our leading product is the genetically modified seed, Everseed. Everseed is the seed. It is a phenomenon. If you were a seed, you'd want to be Everseed. It is the seed that all the other seeds only dream of being, but they aren't. It has been modified to protect itself from unpredictable weather conditions due to climate change. It can resist plant diseases and pests. No more malnourished leaves looking like they've been part of a target practice. Out of their crops. They have no choice but to work closely with us. We offer them microbial seed treatments which work in the same way as probiotics work for us. It's like Actimel for plants. This means that they have early development, immune system support, and nutrient fixation. For us, this means greater efficiency, less waste, and best of all, more money. I know I could do with a few of those treatments. Old Tommy, I should preach, tell the world who we are, what we do, and how we help the world. lapping up the word vomit, and the lies just keep coming and coming and coming. I can see them swarming around my mouth. Yes, so. I'm stuck in a world of suits and ties. I can just see them stacking the paper and the money so high, making their own stairway to heaven. It pays well. Nearly as much as my male peers, but I should be grateful for that, right? My morals, they've become numb, stuck in an ISA in the seed bank, and the mask is becoming the face, and soon I'll be sat round the fiery pits, burning fuels and dinosaur bones and Jurassic plants, and watching the small people dance as we clap. Catch it, kill it, bin it. Everseed is guaranteed for us to get the best yield out of every acre. We sell them seeds, which then spread to their neighbours' fields, and then my colleagues scour the fields to check that their seeds have bred, while the farmers are distracted by putting their children to bed. And then we send them a pretty little letterhead telling them how we wish to sue them for using our product. In the 1960s, a farmer could only feed up to 25 people with their crops. With Everseed, it's up to 155. These farmers have owned their land for centuries, and then we come along and take over and leave them feeling like patients with dementia, walking home alone. They're lost, they're confused, and they're scared. Out of my control. It started as a seed, a tiny little niggle that's manifested itself into opium, developing like a flower of sweet poison that's slowly destroying my nervous system. I can't quit. Like a mouse in treacle, I'm trapped by debt and a mortgage. A tiger doesn't lose sleep over the opinions of sheep. Tiger doesn't lose sleep over the opinions of sheep. A tiger doesn't lose sleep over the opinions of sheep. A tiger doesn't lose sleep over the opinions of sheep, and nor does Everseed. Are you all listening? Statistically, in Europe, three farms disappear every minute. We are taking away the fear of job loss and replacing it with comfort, knowing they can provide for their families. We are taking better care of their land so they can take better care of themselves. Happier farmers plus happier crops equals happier.
Constantly gets in the way of my body. It stops me from taking all the risks I could with it and exploring it fully. I never had the courage to climb as a kid, be it trees or a simple park fence. I used to just freeze in a complex consideration of unnecessary mathematical equations of the height of the wall, the pivot in space, the probability of getting gored by barbed wire or fall into my inevitable doom. I think I carried that perpetual risk assessment into my life philosophy. Every obstacle I encounter, I freeze. Why risk scaling a wall when the majority have a gate or gap somewhere on ground level? The trouble is, quite often when you're looking for an access point in the world around you, by the time you've found one, the thing you wanted to reach has already passed you by. We surround ourselves with walls every day. As much as we tell ourselves they're there to keep us safe and secure from the bad stuff, I think they mainly end up trapping us in. Why do we spend so much time dividing ourselves? All across history we've been building walls. The Berlin Wall, Adrian's Wall, the Great Wall of China. Still today we contemplate building 2,000 mile long walls across the borders of Mexico as we tighten regulations on immigration and trade. Stand by as glacial walls of ice crumble, flooding the homes of others. But that's okay, because our walls are still safe. So we sit around in a wall of silence. We construct mental walls with the technology around us, with Facebook and Twitter, Snapchat in the shadows of a memory, with Xbox Ones and PS3s and 4s, with DVDs in HD, with Samsung S7 minis and with Game Boy Advance SPs. But as this wall of letters and numbers forms around us, are we really any more secure? Shouldn't we have grown out of using nightlights by now? Frustration overwhelms me. I feel like bringing a bulldozer to the barricade and bashing the whole colossal structure down to rubble. But then I remember all those radicalized souls who already followed that narrative behind walls of their own. A steely wall incarcerating the heart with hate and anger and bitterness. Violence breeds violence like a virus, and the wall remains intact. Impotent, frustration, unbearable. Walk away with filthy carbon footprints. Let other fools chip away at unbreakable diamond walls. Tell myself I don't care, believe myself. And then wonder why I'm so disillusioned with the human race, with myself. Because I'm too busy living my pseudo-hedonistic lie. Somehow transported to a memory. I'm a child, my grandma insisted on another outing to the local country park. It was full of forest and lake, bright purple bluebells and the smell of wild garlic. Each uphill hike was justified by the secret brooks off the beaten track of the beaten track, the roaring waterfalls under the wooden slat bridges, and the feeling of accomplishment when you reached a peak. I think of how free it felt, all my fears and anxieties locked up in a flat back in Manchester, each obstacle a challenge to be overcome. I think of that old gnarled tree from that childhood family photo, where family had come from all across the world, how we helped each other scale its branches, a sense of support connecting us together with each other and our environment. Then I remember the day that I found myself trapped on the wrong side of a wall that all my friends had already managed to traverse with ease. That day, there was no gate or gap to squeeze through. That day, fueled by fear, I was brave enough to try to make it to the other side. I inevitably froze mid-climb, refusing to go forward or back, panicked. The salivating teeth of a rabid dog gnashing at my heels, a 6-foot drop to merciless concrete willing me to fall. But then I remember, I'm not still stuck up some wall in the middle of nowhere. My friends didn't just abandon me with an, oh well. They pulled me up, they held me down, they supported me. Has compassion grown as stigmatized as callousness in our modern society? Even if it has, that support system, that connection is crucial to the conservation of our species and our planet. There are countless walls that unite us. There are still people who care. Like that group of engineers in Canada who are working on the technology for constructing the first wall of carbon dioxide consuming cubes. There are billions of people on this dying planet that share my thoughts, my beliefs, that feel the same as me. Each dissent and demonstration, each protest and petition, it does slowly chip away at that diamond wall of carbon. until finally we break through. So now I'm skydiving and scuba diving, I'm base jumping, I'm bungee jumping, I'm snowboarding while there's still some snow to board on, and I'm starting parkour next week. Because when the wind's racing through my hair or the water's embracing me, when great chunks of white spray up from the mountainside like a fanfare, I just let go of all those inhibitions. I follow my intuition and just exist alongside nature. Fear and impotence evaporate. And if I can recondition my body to dare to overcome the obstacles around it, then my mind, inspired by that courage, will follow in its wake.
I work at forest school, where we take the children out to the forest, let them explore their surroundings, be with nature, and see how it all works together. Where they can take risks and use tools to create shelters and dens, work in a team to overcome challenges, climb trees, forage for food, simply just play and enjoy. But as I look around, as I sit and observe, I can't help but feel a pang of sadness, a bang of thoughts twirling to my head, because I worry about them, I worry about how they'll end up, I worry about how they're going to cope in a world that's filled with hate and driven by greed. They look so natural in the forest, but signs of the unnatural are everywhere, seeping in through the air that we breathe, in the litter that is mixed into the dirt, and in them, in the children, in the way that they interact with each other, the things that they say, the way that they hold themselves. I can see how the world has already begun to shape them. My mind begins to wonder. My mind begins to wonder about what they will become. All you need to do is take that vine there, yeah, there you go, pull it round, yeah, and through the hole, yeah, that's it, okay, yeah, now pull it through, yeah, really tight, now tie a knot, okay, you ready, here we go, woo, your very own slingshot. Robbie's favourite thing to do is play PlayStation, all evening on most days, and the games that he plays are way above his age, way above what a child should see. I mean, what good could come from a 10-year-old being locked inside a room for hours on an end, stealing cars, robbing and killing people with an AK-47? I can't see no good in that. And if he's inside all the time, how is he gonna know that he is a part of nature? How can we expect him to care if he doesn't even know what he's missing? As nature cannot be felt through a screen, it's felt through our being. If all the future generation sees is a screen filled with blood, then that is all we will become. A world filled with blood. A world filled with screens, filled with the blood of us. Our children are just blank canvases that we're painting. But what pictures are we making? No, don't worry. I won't let you fall, right? You just need to get your left hand on that branch, yeah? That's it, okay? And push up. Oh, go on, you can do it. Come on, it's okay. Right, okay. There you go. All right, one more step. That's it, you got it, man. Yeah. How's it feel up there? Albie is so overweight that it hurts. He can't run for a minute without losing his breath. I can hear the wheezing in his chest. What will become of him in the future? If he's not careful, he'll end up 40 with diabetes. He'll never experience what it feels like to run, to dance, to move freely without any restrictions. And this will make him isolated, and people will call him names that will push him away. And these names, they stick. You can act that they don't, but these names, they stick and create scars in your heart. I don't want for him to have scars that will take years to heal and tear him apart. Already he shows no consideration for his environment. He walks on plants, squishing them as they get in his way. No real concept of sharing, no real concept of kindness. But when will plants become people? When will not sharing turn to stealing? When will he get so reckless that he crashes his car and he burns?
Thomas, go on. Here, take it. See? Oh, it's lovely.
Oh, Gabriella, the girl with the handbag, the lipstick straight in hair. You see, where Gabriella lives, there's not much love around. I can already see what beliefs are being formed in her vulnerable form. That she's not good enough. That love is something she can always nearly reach, but never quite touch. I don't want for her to hide inside all of these mechanisms that she's created to help her cope, to make herself smaller, so somebody will save her, or to make herself taller, so that somebody will praise her, or to spend her life being self-destructive so somebody shows her that they care, while obstructing any signs of love because it's simply never been there and she's scared. I wish that I could warn her that she gets too involved in her ego, but I can see it's already being watered and is beginning to grow. That self-worth does not come from other people's eyes or in a mirror, but self-worth comes from inside and it can't be broken, as nothing can stop her. In fact, I wish I could just tell all of these kids not to get too swept up in all of this meaningless shit. Not to get too swept away by chasing what they're told they should, but to actually just chase their dreams. As this life is just a journey, so for them to just enjoy the ride, there is no rush, just take their time. As what's important is how much that they love, how much they listen, and how much that they care. And most of all, I just hope with all of my heart that when they grow up, they will love who they are, each and every single part. And that makes me think about David Cameron, Donald Trump, and Putin. And I wonder what they were like when they were a kid.
Emotion to have in oneself. Fear is how we fall. Because when the darkness sets into the mind, the heart soon follows. Swallowed by an abyss that's in every chromosome and cell until it's all you are. Watching others around you just scurry around with the pitiful lives living in a fantasy. My world's gone, crashed down and destroyed. And you stand there with that smile, that fucking pathetic smile. I just want to slash it from your face and watch you slither along the ground like the serpent you are. But wait, what's this? Power, a joy, a voice deep down screaming, hurt, no, yes, no, yes, no, enough! Fear of falling back into the dark. Madness. Because what's worse than watching your life drip away every single minute? Find that light in the dark. Find the beauty inside. Because no rain, no rainbow. You must fall so you can rise. Because there's a war of two wolves within each and every one of us. One is good. Joy. Peace, love, hope, humility, kindness, and truth. The other is evil. Anger, greed, resentment, inferiority, lies, and ego. But which one wins? Well, I say to you, it's the one you feed. The shit's chess, man. Just move each pawn out of your way, the obstacles in life. Move forward, move back. Slide diagonally and slide off the rails for a while. It's fine. Until you hit check. That moment when you feel like you're going to win the game, but the opponent, the problem you're facing in life just might reach the end of the board before you and your heart starts to pace and you're just craving that win. But stay focused, stay strong. I promise you'll hit checkmate. I remember the last time I was here. The warmth of a morning breeze slowly rubbing my skin. And the smell of the moist sweat from me and my friend. The warmth just set over my head like a blanket, and the grass my bed just tickled me slightly when I lay. The sound of the river flow, a symphony to my ears, a song of the earth, connecting you to it. You feel life in your being, and the air breathes it into you. And then I see her, her hair just like the sun and the warmth. It felt like she was the sun just warming my soul. The smell of a perfume consuming, hypnotizing, and a smile that could brighten the darkest day. And the eyes as blue as the river and sky. It felt like she was the sun and I the moon, ready to change to light in the dark hour. She leaves, we exchange that lover's kiss and my heart starts to race. Even the river speeds up as though it's my heart just racing like a river of love. The heart stays strong and the earth brings me life and joy once more. Fuck. Oh, you want it? Go on then. Now, the world must fucking hate us. I mean, we're a virus polluting it, killing it. We sever its branches and burn fuels to the sky, and so the heavens recede like a scroll being rolled up. We lose our ozone layer. More sun rays, more heat, right? God, we're thick as fuck. I mean, do you really want to be burned alive? The Lord created the earth and then escaped because we're dumb by nature and selfish. Humans really are the biggest virus on the planet. And soon, the virus must die. Dumping toxins into Mother Earth's river. You choke her with your nuclear plants till all she can breathe is a poisonous fume. Dumping toxins into her womb. You make her abort her children without consent. Why the fuck should we be able to live on her, really? Oh shit, she's fucking fighting! But wait. It's an animal, it's a dog. She's doing what she's supposed to do. Humans kill indiscriminately. So who are the real animals? War just raging, man's inhumanity to man. All Cain, no Abel. The murderer rather than the shepherd of the flock. The destroyer rather than the savior. Only the dead have seen the end of war. End war now, before it ends us. I mean, war is just fear cloaked with courage. And tax. Steal our life away through some pathetic system. Offering up our wages like an offering to ancient gods. Why the fuck should they be able to dictate what money we get? And that cretin of a woman's face just staring back at you with a smile and the golden crown like a goddess that you're not. Your blood is the same colour as mine, you're no different. But a walking fool on the planet, barking orders and ruling us. There can only be one king ruler, and that's God himself. And even he doesn't smile upon us for our actions. Our race truly has fallen. Shh, can you hear that? Shh, listen and hear the flood.
Sing no victim song. I am freedom, I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs. For I am an endangered species, and I sing no victim song. I am freedom, I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs. For I am an endangered species, and I sing no victim song. I am human, I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs. I am human, I exist. I shake my fist with the words from my lips.
My mind is set, my body is strong. I sing of rebirth, no victim song.
For I am an endangered species, and I sing no victim song. I am freedom. I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs. Oh, I am an endangered species, sing no victim song. I am freedom, I am an artist, and I know where my voice belongs, and I know where my soul belongs, and I know where my heart belongs.